So I can go at length if I want.
You can go at full length.
I tend to, as she well knows, I tend to just, once I start talking, I'll try to be more succinct if I can. I've noticed that I have a tendency to gesticulate a lot, and so sometimes it looks weird because I'm like...
Gesticulation is good.
Morton makes fun of me about this almost every day now. Everyone on Team Imitation now does a set of impressions of me. Alan Leach, who's in our cast, does the best one. It's terrifying. He did it for my mom last week, and I have never lived this down.
Wow.
Yeah.
You now have actors mocking you.
I know. I'm getting really self-conscious about it because Alan's is so good, and I did not realize that's what my... Whatever. My voice sounded like, but yeah, I'm getting pretty funny about it.
And no making fun of Morton? Is that the...
Oh, no, everyone does a good Morton impression, too. Okay. That's, I mean, it's too... actually, I think Benedict's Morton impression is the best. His is, if you talk to him, ask him to do it, it's amazing. The actors all compete to do different Morton impressions.
A man of many impressions.
Yeah. He is very good, as we've seen, at impressions.
Yes, he's brilliant at it. So you are a little bit out of nowhere in this experience. I mean, you came from, you did a couple shorts, you did a TV show, that's all I can find, and then you have an Academy Award nomination.
Yeah, I mean, nowhere being Chicago in this example. I did come from somewhere. But not England. I mean, I'm not British, which I think shocks a lot of people.
Well, I meant more in the showbiz parlance of coming from somewhere. But I mean, you, what was the journey to becoming an Oscar-nominated screenwriter?
Man, if you'd told me earlier in the journey that that's where we were going to end up, I'm sure the whole process would have been very different. I couldn't have imagined.
Well, you're still just starting, really.
Yeah, I know.
You're but a young man.
I thank you for saying so. I'm glad you feel that way.
Are you feeling old?
I don't know. I mean, it's like we're coming to the end of the Imitation Game, and like, as you know, the movie's out, we're doing the sort of award stuff. But like, I just did the DVD commentary last week with Morton, and I had this like really sad moment of like, oh, this is like one of the last times we're going to get to like sit in a room and talk about Alan Turing together. Like I've been doing this every day of my life for 5 years. Mm-hmm. And now, it's sort of coming to an end. Ito, one of our producers, was saying the other night, he was like, does it feel like it's the end of college and now we have to go get real jobs? I was kind of like, yeah, I guess so. Like, we'll just go do another movie, but we don't really want to do another movie. We just wanted to do this one. And I think that's sort of the answer to your question, is that we really wanted to make this movie, and we really wanted to tell Alan Turing's story on screen. I mean, I've been obsessed with Turing's story since I was a teenager.
Starting when? What was the first?
In 7th, 8th grade, I went to space camp. I went to computer programming camp. I had this big plan that I was going to grow up and be a computer programmer. And so among kind of awkward techie teenagers without a lot of friends, you know, Turing was such an inspiration. He was this sort of campfire legend, this guy who never fit in his own time, who was such an outsider in his own day and age for so many reasons, but who precisely because he didn't fit in, saw the world in a way that no one else had and was able to think up these ideas that no one else had ever thought of before and sort of was able to change the world because of it. And it was always this tremendously important story for me, and I think...
Do you remember when you first heard about him?
I don't remember like the exact first moment. I'm sure it would have been at space camp probably, or computer programming camp or something like that. I remember it was something we'd talk about. Like, Turing's name was known among the sort of techie community, and I think since the 80s, you know, his name is known in the tech community. I mean, Steve Jobs wrote about him a lot as far back as the 80s. There had long been this rumor, you know, that the logo of Apple Computer, an apple with a bite taken out of it, was Jobs' silent tribute to Alan Turing, because Turing killed himself by, you know, taking an apple, dipping it in cyanide, and then eating it. We think that rumor is probably not true, but it's a lovely thought nonetheless. And Jobs wrote lovingly about Turing. Gates wrote a lot about Turing and talked a lot about Turing as an inspiration. So in the sort of computer science community, Turing was very well known, but I think wasn't as popularly known. And that always seemed like such a surprise to me as I got older, that it was, here is this guy whose name should be as well known as Einstein's, as Newton's, as Darwin's. I think his accomplishments are very much on their level, but his name is not as well known as Einstein's because I would suggest he was a gay man at a time
when you became conscious of him. I mean, this is after the fact that he had done these things historically. and how he died and everything else had become public knowledge, yes?
Yes. I mean, I think starting Andrew Hodges' book that we optioned is sort of the first major biography of Turing came out in 1983. So after that point, it became a bit more public.
Three.
Two, yes,
okay.
So I read it when I was two. I mean, it was my favorite book in my crib or whatever. No, I didn't find
Dr.
it until later,
Seuss
but the name...
Alan Turing.
Yeah, I mean, Andrew deserves a world of credit. I mean, it's because of Andrew that Turing's name became popularized even to the degree that it did in the 80s, which, I mean, Andrew did sort of phenomenal work on that in terms of petitioning the government for the declassification of further material. And then we learned a lot more about Turing starting in the 1990s because some of the secrecy surrounding Bletchley Park was lifted and people who'd been there began to be able to legally talk about their experiences.
And that was probably happening around the same time you were first really aware of him.
Yeah. So I think some more material was sort of coming to light then. And, you know, which is amazing to think about, too, because these people had, you know, kept the secret for 50 years. I mean, some of them were then in their 80s and 90s, and for 50 years, they hadn't told a soul what they'd done. And so a lot of Turing's and Bletchley's accomplishments were still top secret up until that point.
So when did the idea that this was a screenplay first become part of your life?
Turing's story always seemed so innately important and innately compelling that it felt like, it had always felt to me since I was a teenager that, like, if anyone deserved to have a film made about him, it was Alan Turing. And it always surprised me that no one had. I mean, as someone who watches a lot of movies, as someone who loves movies, it was always like, how come no one's made a movie about Alan Turing? Like, it's such an obviously compelling and important story. You know, his story had been told, there'd been great books, there was a wonderful play, never like a proper piece of narrative film. Mm-hmm. So I'd kind of always wanted to. And I, you know, I moved to LA about 6 years ago, and I remember when I moved to LA, and even before that, when I was living in New York, kind of ringing people up and saying, hey, you know, there's this movie we could make about a gay English mathematician in the 1940s, and... oh, at the end, he's going to commit suicide. And you hear all those Hollywood buzzwords just getting sort of thrown around, and everyone got really excited about it.
Well, 6 years ago, what were you? I mean, were you a screenwriter?
I was trying to be a screenwriter. I had moved to LA with... 6 years ago, I'd written a couple things with my best friend, Ben. We were living in New York. We were roommates. We were starting to write some scripts together, some sort of light comedy things. I was working on my first novel, which then came out 4 years ago. So 6 years ago, I kind of gave up being a professional writer. I was like, I got to this moment where we tried to write a number of things, couldn't get a job, couldn't get work. It was like, okay, screw it. I give up. I quit. Mm-hmm. I couldn't hack it. Like we couldn't make it work. And my friend Ben, my then writing partner, who now lives across the street from me and is still my best friend, was like, no, let's move to LA, let's give it a couple months, let's try it, like, let's not give up. And I was like, no, I'm sorry, I'm done, I'm out. Like, there is enough rejection for a lifetime. I'm gonna go do something else. I guess we're just not that good at it. And my manager, Tom, who was my manager then and is still my manager now, we were out in LA for a couple of meetings for some jobs that we didn't get. Mm-hmm. And Tom called me into his office and was like, I think you should move to LA, give it a few months. Ben's right. He personally wrote me a check that day for a couple thousand dollars to get a plane ticket to LA and move out. And, you know, I lived on my friend Tony's couch for 6 months in Silver Lake when I got here trying to find a job. And then, sure enough, within a few months, we got a job writing on a sitcom called 10 Things I Hate About You on the ABC Family Channel, which was still the best job I've ever had. It was so much fun. It was great, and I'm still really close to every single writer on that staff. I mean, we talk all the time. And then I finished my first novel. We sold that, and then... and then I quit again. Then I was like, oh, I really love working on this book. I'm going to go move back to New York and just write books from now on. And I don't want to write screenplays anymore because Hollywood is so... people don't seem to like making the kinds of movies that I like seeing. And this is just not working out. So, And I was so excited about my book. And it was such a wonderful process. And then I met our producers, Nora Grossman and Ido Ostrowski. who at a cocktail party. And they had the rights to Andrew Hodge's biography of Alan Turing, and they didn't have a writer, and so I started stalking them.
So how does that come up at a cocktail party? I mean, were they just talking about their project?
Yeah, I mean, I've been in LA for a little while. I didn't really know that many people, and I'd met Nora once briefly, and I don't know why I got invited to this party. I really barely knew her. I think I genuinely think she thought I was a different Graham, like when she was putting together the email list. She denies this now, but I think she's lying. You can tell her I said that, because she's one of my best friends now. But so I got to the party and didn't really know anyone. I like saw her in the kitchen and sort of came up and said, hi. I was like, hey, it's Graham, the other one. What's up? And she said, I said, what's going on? And she said, oh, you know, I want to be a producer. And so I optioned my first book. And I said, cheers, have another one of these weird Saint Germain cocktails that you really like. What's the book about? And she, I swear to God, she said, it's this biography of this mathematician. You've never heard of him. Don't worry about it. And I said, well, I know a little bit about math. What's his name? And she said, Alan Turing. And so I just instantly, you know, lost my shit and started screaming. And was like, oh my God, I've dreamed about doing this forever. Like, I can't believe you have the rights. I'll write it on spec. I'll start right now. I'll drop everything. Like, I don't care. I have to be a part of this. And she was like inching away from me step by step. Like, who is this person? Like, did I invite him? Who's he friends with? How did he get in here? Why is he attacking me? And so over a period of weeks, I began begging her and her producing partner, Ito, to let me come on and write the spec, which we then spent a year doing. Mm-hmm. And I think I felt in terms of like my career that it was like, okay, I wasn't sure if I really wanted to work in film anymore. I wasn't sure if movies like this could even get made. I mean, I felt pretty discouraged about the ability to do something like that. But it was like, this is a once in a lifetime opportunity to do something that felt really important and that really mattered. And, you know, I would joke, I remember being on set and I would joke that like, I would have been a PA on the set of The Imitation Game, like just to be a part of that.
So movies like this, as you've said a couple times now, I mean, this is what The Imitation Game is the kind of movie that you like.
It is. Yeah. I mean, it's unconventional in a lot of ways. It's really, I mean, I think the goal with this film was always, can we take some really difficult, really unconventional subject matter and try and translate into something that can resonate with a broader audience?
But it's pretty Sirkian, I mean, at heart.
Yeah,
I mean,
absolutely.
That's the kind of movie that you're drawn to. You, you know, an old-fashioned drama.
Is that fair? Yeah, I mean, I like drama. I really like dramas. I like crying at movies. I also cried at everything. I'm such a crier.
Fault in Our Stars. You almost died, probably.
Well, and you know, one of the things that Morton talked about, one of the things I really loved about the way when he, I mean, we're cutting forward a few years, but when he came on as a director, one of the things that I loved about his vision for it was that he had this aesthetic idea that like the movie should feel timeless. One of the first things he said to me was, I want this to be a film where you're not quite sure what year it was made. It could have been made in 2014 or 2004 or 1994 or 1984, and you're not totally sure. Mm. And so we had all these kind of aesthetic rules for ourselves, and I did writing, and then other departments did, you know, Oscar Faura, our DP, can talk about, there were certain rules for him as a DP because of that, certain angles, certain camera motions that couldn't be used because they were sort of, we would say they were too sort of modern. Fancy schmancy, that was Morton's word for the term. He's like, too fancy schmancy. No fancy schmancy. And it was interesting for me as a writer sort of seeing that from the beginning and then watching those aesthetic principles carry through from department to department. So even watching the way they became applied to, the score, to Alexandra's beautiful score, you know, using only period instruments, but tweaking them, you mm-hmm. know, like the main theme is, it's a piano, right? Like we had pianos in 1940. Only it's three pianos, and they've been sequenced slightly out of order from each other, so mm-hmm. it's like using a computer to sort of like mess with, it's like using modern technology to mess with 1940 technology. I think, yeah, when you talk about the timelessness of the film, that's sort of what we always talked about, that it was, Alan Turing was a man out of time, mm. And so we wanted the film to, in some sense, feel out of time.
So Billy Goldenberg was here a couple of weeks ago.
Oh, yeah.
So I don't know that I actually coined the phrase, but we were talking about the complaint that the film is not gay enough was the phrase I used, which we both had a big laugh about.
Sure.
It sounds politically terrible, but I mean, that is the first thing that came out of Toronto, outside of people who love the film, which there were plenty of and still are plenty of, was this kind of first complaint about the movie, was that somehow it wasn't gay enough. Was this ever an issue for you? Was this something that you intentionally didn't go in that direction? What is the creator's take on that?
Yeah, it's so funny. Like, that was, obviously we had, Alan Turing's homosexuality seemed to us so fundamentally a part of the story, and it seemed so fundamental to the story and to the film. We were honestly sort of surprised by it. I mean, I think the film, if anything, the whole sort of big theme of the movie is this concept of the imitation game, which is what the movie's called. It's in the title. The big thematic thing going on in the movie is that the imitation game is this scientific concept that changes computers, it changes artificial intelligence, it changes philosophy. This is one of the most important sort of big ideas of the 20th century, and it came from a closeted gay man in Britain in the 1940s, and it could only have come from a closeted gay man in Britain in the 1940s. In Turing's Imitation Game is this idea, in a nutshell, it's this idea that we are only what we can convince other people that we are. We are human to the degree that we can convince someone else that we are human. And I thought that in Alan's Imitation Game, this was his... I mean, the idea that that's this philosophical concept, and then it becomes a mathematical and computational one, you see so much of his personal life being writ into these theories. And that's what we wanted to make, that's what we wanted the movie to do. We wanted to talk about how his personal experience as a gay man who was necessarily closeted because his sexuality was illegal affected these theories, and how it affected his work. And you know, one thing we talked about, at every stage of it, was how would we treat him if he was a straight character? Like, I think that Alan Turing didn't think that his sexuality was particularly noteworthy. I mean, he was certainly, like, he acknowledged himself as a gay man and talked about it to the people who were close to him, and he knew it was illegal, obviously, and he knew he couldn't talk about it to the wider world. But I think... you know, he thought of himself as a mathematician first and foremost. And I think this idea that the movie isn't gay enough, as you say, because we don't see him having sex. Like, there's no sex scene. It's like, if it was a movie about a straight mathematician, you would never say that. You would never say, like, well, we don't see him have sex, so how do we know that he's really straight?
So I will say that if you had a film like this and you had Kira, you know, opposite whoever was playing the straight Alan Turing, that you would... part of this kind of movie would be some sort of physical love at some point. Maybe
sure.
Not ornate, but, you know.
Well, I mean, that was one of the things...
You would assume that is going to be part of the film.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I do not think that Alan Turing and Joan Clarke, who Keira Knightley plays, right. Ever had sex.
No, but I'm just saying, if there were this love story that could never happen for whatever reason,
yeah.
In a straight movie, and you had a beautiful actress, and you had a beautiful leading man, you would kind of expect the sex scene.
You would.
In this case, it's not the movie.
Right.
They always talk about fitting in the, you know, one of his dalliances at a club or something. And I'm like, I don't know exactly how this fits into the movie.
Right. It didn't really seem like it would fit into the narrative. And, like, what dalliance exactly were we supposed to have included? I mean, he didn't. I think Alan Turing fell in love only once in his life, and that was with Christopher Morcom when he was a teenager. I think that he loved Morcom very much. I mean, he wrote about Christopher for the rest of his life. He wrote letters to Christopher's mother until Christopher's mother died in 1941. Mm-hmm. He, you know, even up until the 50s, Turing was still writing in letters in his journals about Christopher. And I think he never fell in love again. I think, and we wanted to show that. I mean, I think we wanted to make a film that was about love, not about sex. Mm-hmm. And and we wanted to show how important Christopher was. You know, Turing was celibate during the Bletchley years, which is where most of the film takes place. He was famously so, and not by choice. Mm. He wrote in a letter to a friend that Bletchley Park was a sexual desert. That was the phrase he used. And, you know, he, because it was illegal, like, he couldn't just sort of run off to some pub or something. Like, right. If he was caught, he would have been kicked out of the military. He went sent to jail, which is later what then, you know, yeah. He did end up getting caught in the 50s. So, you know, it's not like there's some boyfriend or something that we cut out of the story. There wasn't one.
Well, I mean, it's funny because I've had I'm kind of on your side on this whole thing and have been, I basically feel like the movie is, as I said, Sirkian. There's an old fashioned feel to it, and that, you know, having a random sex partner at some point in his life just to show that he was a functional gay man and actually had sex in his life and was not a eunuch seemed kind of like not what you would do in one of those movies. However, it's fascinating to read all the kind of picking beyond that issue even by people. And it feels like you guys, from the first time I met you back in Toronto,
yeah.
very invested in this man's story and this man's life and knowing everything you could and presenting him in a way that you thought was favorable and caring and all of that. Is it just surreal to have people kind of like, is there an argument to be made about all of this stuff? Is it a debate? Is it a...
Oh, the sort of fact-checking stuff?
Well, this kind of like, you know, he was funnier, he was this or he was that or...
It is, yeah, there's something, I think, look, we have no audio of Alan Turing. We have no video of Alan Turing. We are compiling him based entirely on people's recollections of him and his own writings. I think, you know, in general, a lot of the sort of fact-checking articles that come out about any historical film...
Very unpopular this year.
Yeah, people love those. Man, I guess readers are really... I don't...
It's just been a giant... This year has been a giant clusterfuck. It's been a big fight over every single thing.
It's been bizarre. As someone who really loves film and as someone who really loves history, it's been bizarre to watch because I think it's this sort of fundamental misunderstanding of like what film is and how film works. You know, it's not... I think the entire concept of fact-checking a historical film sort of misses the point. Like, a film is it's a piece of art that should not be a terribly, like, tendentious concept. And as such, you know, those are the standards by which it's judged. Like, the goal with this film was always to represent the sort of the core of Alan Turing, the heart of him, fairly and accurately, and to present his story, to bring his story to an audience. You know, I think I think one of the most beautiful moments for us as a team was, you know, I think probably around about when I saw you in Toronto, maybe just after we had a private, or probably just before, we had a private screening of the film for a dozen or so members of Turing's family. Mm. Including one of his nieces, who was 18 when he passed away. So she has some pretty good memories of him. And we had talked to her before filming, and Benedict had met with her, and we'd gotten some memories from her. And after the screening, you know, she told Benedict it was... Watching the movie felt like watching her uncle alive again. Mm. And his whole family felt that we had just gotten him perfectly and really nailed who he was as a person. And... that for us was the most meaningful thing. I mean, that for us was like, okay, the people who knew him really think we got it right. And the people who loved him and cared about him as their family feel like we got it right. And that's the most meaningful thing for us.
You don't even get started on Foxcatcher. But... I don't know if you've been following that whole drama, but
I've seen little, yeah, bits of the drama.
Now Dave Schultz is all pro Foxcatcher again. And you know, it's the greatest movie ever made and everybody should win Oscars. So It's swinging around pretty good.
I'm glad he's being supportive.
Is it, I mean, so as in this place where you have this great romance with your movie and the experience and this whole time you've put in, the 5 years plus on this subject, is all of this a distraction from all the success? I mean, you guys have all these Academy Award nominations, you have box office, you have, you know, a lot of everything positive, and yet there's this weird kind of niggling... thing, do you just kind of like go, okay, there's nothing to say about it and I'm moving on? And
oh, you mean about the criticisms? I mean, it's a movie. Some people are going to like it, some people are not going to like it. Like, that's
Is it in the way of your joy? I mean, does it bother you much at all, or do you kind of like just have to shrug it off and keep on going? And
are you asking if I'm like good about having my like Taylor Swift "Shake It Off" moment, which I certainly hope to have? Yeah, sometimes I think sometimes when criticism seems like it's not playing fair, I get upset about it. You know, like in some of the historical accurate, I have read a number of like fact-checking the Imitation Game pieces mm-hmm. that are so riddled with errors. But we're in this position where like we can't respond because then it creates a story and it like metastasizes and it grows. And so just like, but I'm like, wait, these people don't actually know what they're talking about. And they read one book once that they sort of skimmed, and like, we've actually met with the people who were involved, and what they told us happened was blah, blah, blah. And so that stuff gets difficult, but at the same time...
Well, somebody said that, somebody wrote a piece recently I saw somewhere that, you know, like it's so odd that Turing would confuse his computer for the actual Christopher, and I'm like, I don't think that's what happened.
That's not what we were showing. No, he doesn't, he's
like
not
hallucinating. Like
he's not hallucinating. Like, he knows, the point was, yes, the point of calling the machine Christopher in the film was that he...
I got it.
Yeah, the Imitation Game thing, like this whole idea that like, and he wrote, Turing wrote explicitly in letters and journals that his whole project of artificial intelligence, his whole idea behind the computer was this notion of, can we bring someone who passed away, can we preserve consciousness past the point of death? That was his like primary use for this new technology, which is amazing when you think about the fact that he had this, his sort of great love die so young. Mm-hmm. What we were trying to, that was sort of a dramatic invention to show this connection in his mind and his heart between his work on artificial intelligence and computers and then his love of Christopher, which every single Turing biographer and every single expert agrees is the case. I mean, this is not, mm-hmm. there's no like debate about this. Yeah, it becomes sort of funny. I don't know, but then it's like, yeah, people say bad things, but you also, like, I got a letter the other week. I got an email from a guy who said that he's in his 90s, and he was convicted under the same criminal statute that Alan Turing was in the 1950s. He was convicted of gross indecency, and he was put in jail. He's gay, this man who wrote me this letter, and he said that he's never talked about it publicly. You know, after he got out of jail, there was such shaming around it, and he didn't talk about it publicly and all the stuff. But he saw the movie a few weeks ago, and he cried, and it was so beautiful, and he feels like he can, like, talk about these experiences now, and he's going to write about it, and he's going to write about what happened to him. And I started crying when I got the letter. It was, like, it was so beautiful and so meaningful. And I think that's what feels important, you know, mm-hmm. that man could have seen the movie and could find something in it and could see something from his own life brought up on the screen in that way felt... That seems so much more meaningful than, I don't know, some article or something.
Well, it's funny because we don't know, the public doesn't, or nor the press really knows you, doesn't really know you or Morden or a lot of the other people involved with the movie. Passingly, a few of them, as some of the producers have popped up before, but, you know, really don't have, so the only real relationship was with Benedict, mm-hmm. who's also relatively new to all this, even though he's so famous. But you talk to Benedict, and it's like, he's so serious, and he's so protective of Turing that you realize, I mean, talking to you guys, you can feel the passion, but with having some sense of Benedict already being a very straight player, mm-hmm. The idea that he would dance around anything or, you know, the whole thing is so clearly a positive message about being gay.
Yeah.
And about the horrors of being limited in that way. It's kind of shocking that it's become
anything
at all besides positive in that regard.
Yeah. You know, criticisms of films are one thing. Like, people are free to criticize. People are free to not like the movie. Like, there's all sorts of movies you can not like. But to criticize our intentions or our passion behind this, I think, is a little bit backhanded and unfair. I mean, I remember all of the long days and late nights I'd spent with Benedict and Morton in London, sort of going through researching the chemical castration element of the story together and talking about it and trying to figure it out and getting information and exactly what was the exact estrogen compound that was being injected into his body and all that. I mean, we were so passionate about this and, you know, we had so little time to make this movie. I mean, we shot the whole thing in 8 weeks. And so we had this great sort of 3-week rehearsal period where we just locked ourselves in a room for 3 weeks and everyone sort of did as much, and then we'd like, go home and everyone would do their own research and come back and like sort of comparing things and contrasting things and sort of trying to find the heart of the story. But it was, I'm so proud of our team of people from Benedict and Kira, and the rest of the cast, to Morton and our producers. Like we all loved it so much, and I'm so proud that we all got to make the movie that we all wanted to make. And I think,
and in such one last thing, because yeah. of course, one last thing about that, the ending, Billy and I had a chat about that, and apparently you shot the apple. Mm-hmm. From your point of view, it just never quite worked. It didn't feel right.
No, it's funny, and I don't know what Billy said to you about it, though. I was with Billy in editing when we took that scene out. It was, so we shot a scene. We scripted and shot a scene, and it had always been in the script. It's one of those things in the filmmaking process where, like, the thing that you never question in the script, the thing that you're like, oh, well, there's no way we're ever going to cut that, is the first thing you cut when we got to editing. And Billy taught me a lot about that. So we had a scene where, as I'm sure he described, you see after the bit where Benedict says goodbye to Christopher for the last time and walks into the darkness kind of gently, there's this shot-for-shot matching of the first scene of the film where the cop comes into the house and sort of finds Turing's dead body on the bed, and it's sort of blurry in the foreground, and there's a couple cops, and in their conversation you get the sort of information about, oh, it looks like a suicide, apple by the bed, and you see the apple with the bite taken out of it with the cyanide by the bed. And I think it was something where we all sort of saw it in an early assembly, and everyone was like, yeah, that's terrible. We should cut that. I mean, that's not good. I mean, it was just so obviously not great. Like, it's not like we even spent like days debating it. It was like there was no argument. Like, it just didn't really work. I think the problem was that two things. One, showing the apple, it ended up instantly looking like an Apple commercial. Like, the movie had, like, because it looked like the apple, it was just weird. Like, it looked like a commercial. And then the scene, the bit of the cop sort of giving you this biographical information about his suicide felt expositional. It felt like the movie was just giving you data, and we never wanted the movie to feel expositional. We never wanted the movie to feel like, I think sometimes historical films, biopics especially, can sort of feel like there's just a guy standing in front of a camera, like reciting a Wikipedia page to you. Mm-hmm. And that was a scene that felt like we were just reciting a Wikipedia page. Like, there was no drama happening. There was no, like, if the definition of drama of a scene is, like, person X walks into a room, person Y is already there, person X and person Y want completely different things, go. Like, that's drama. That's a scene. At its most sort of rudimentary level, there was no drama there. There was no scene. And we were just sort of chattering at you. And then we looked, and, you know, the scene before, we loved the sort of moment of Benedict walking gently into the darkness, and we thought that was such a beautiful and, like, lyrical way of showing his suicide. And then the monologue that Keira Knightley gave that ended the scene before it, in their final sort of big dramatic scene between the two of them, that monologue seemed to us like, we loved the idea that those would be the last words of the film. We loved the idea that that seemed so much more in fitting with the spirit of the film we were trying to make, that it felt like our eulogy for Alan. We don't know if anyone got to say that to Alan in his life, but we hope so, and it's what we would have liked to have said to him. So we loved ending the film on what we wish we could have said to him.
So I guess all of this Academy stuff. You're going to luncheon on Monday.
Yeah.
Which is, of course, everybody's favorite day.
I've been told the luncheon is really fun. I mean, I've never done it.
Well, very low pressure, and you get to see everybody.
You know, I eat lunch every day, so that'll be a special.
Very few people actually eat lunch at the Academy luncheon.
Oh, okay.
Older Academy members who are visiting, they eat lunch. Everybody else kind of busy.
Should I snack beforehand? I feel like
you might want to snack.
This has been my experience of award season thus far, is like frantically calling Nora or Morton or someone to be like, is this one of the events where I can actually eat food, or where I have to pretend to eat food? Because I get hungry, and if I can't actually eat, then I'm having a sandwich before I get there.
Well, you can actually eat, but you may not want to. You may be too busy wanting to go talk to, you know, Steven Spielberg or
I mean, I
Oprah
would love to meet. I've never met Steven Spielberg. That sounds great. I literally now, like, carry, one of my friends gave me this little thing of peanut butter. It's like a little, like, push thing of peanut butter to keep in my jacket, just because, like, you never know when you're actually going to get to eat, or you have to like pretend to do it and then like talk to someone. It's all very...
I make this paste that's peanut butter flavored for kids in Africa
who
are starving.
I would not like to compare 6,000, my situation. Yeah.
6,000 calories in a tube. You can just, you know, have a week's worth of meals. And.
Yeah, that sounds wonderful. I would not like to compare my situation of having to, like, put on tuxedos and go to
that's
formal
true.
Events.
It's not exactly
it's
the
not,
same.
It's not quite the same situation. But, no, it's exciting. And look, like, it feels like... I have found going to these sorts of events, like, one of the most meaningful experiences for me has been also, like, talking to other filmmakers I really like and really respect, and when other filmmakers I like and respect sort of come and they've seen our movie and they get to talk to us about it, like, those conversations are so fascinating. I mean, at our London premiere, I remember, like, Terry Gilliam came up to me at the thing, and I didn't even know he was there, and, I mean, I recognized him, and he was like, "Hi, are you Graham? Like, did you write this?" And I said, yes, hi, so nice to meet you, Mr. Gilliam, blah, blah, and he was just gushing about the movie and how much he loved it and how much it meant to him, and it was like, I can't even remember any of the rest of that night. It was like, Terry Gilliam liked our movie, like, that's the coolest thing that's ever happened to me. And so, yeah, I think that's been the most fun of these sorts of events, is, like, meeting other filmmakers, especially people like that, whose work I've admired since I was a kid.
So you kind of won already.
In some sense. I mean, look, we got to make our movie. Like, that was the victory. Like, I remember the day we locked picture, and I was like, yeah, we just, like, we did it. We're here. Hopefully we can put it out now, and maybe someone will go see it, but this is the movie I wanted it to be. So that felt like the biggest win.
And now that your college is ending and you're going to throw your hat in the air.
I know. Now we're right. We're going to have our graduation in a couple weeks. Then we all have to go get jobs. I don't even know.
Very fancy graduation ceremony.
But. It sounds like a very nice. And just like my actual college graduation, my mother will be there. It'll be a lot of fun.
And do you know what's coming next? Do you have a plan, or are you kind of waiting to feel something?
Yeah, I'm finishing... I'm finishing a novel. I'm just putting the finishing touches on a novel right now that I had started before The Imitation Game. I literally was starting my second novel. And then when I met Nora and Ito at this party, was like, oh, I'm going to take 6 months away from the novel, write the script about Alan Turing really quickly, and then I'll be back to it in 6 months. 5 years later, we now find ourselves here. But now I'm actually going to get to finish the book, which is great. And then I have... a TV pilot for HBO with the director Michael Mann that we've been working on for a while, that we're sort of getting to the finishing point on now. So hopefully we'll either make
another
our show
version
or not.
Of Alan Turing, really.
He is, in some ways. They're very driven men.
And so is the idea of screenwriting either being part of your life or not? Because it sounds like you started and stopped a few times. Is that like now that's it, now that you're an Oscar-nominated screenwriter? Is that your life? Or
I'm going to retire at 33.
Well, but I mean, do you want to just keep on doing whatever comes, feels right at the right time, or?
Yeah, I don't know. I think I had this experience. Imitation Game, as we've discussed, was my first movie. It was the hardest thing I've ever done. It was the most challenging thing I have ever attempted to do. And I don't know. I remember sometimes Morton and I would drive home together from set. We were in London, and because our little like flats where we were staying in London were right next to each other, and so we would go back and we'd be in the car, and we would both, it was this thing where, you know, it was like 6:30 at night, but we've been there since 5:30 in the morning, and we're both like just totally fried, right, and like exhausted, and it's like, do we try to drink more coffee to like get through dinner, or do we just pass out now? And we're both like totally frazzled, and he would turn to me sometimes and just say, like, God, can you imagine doing this if we didn't love it? Like, can you imagine working this hard on material that we didn't care about this much? Like, he was like, I couldn't do it. And I was like, yeah, I couldn't. God, if we didn't love this story, like, how do you even... I have friends who work on movies that they don't necessarily love that much. And they get paid a lot of money, and that's great. But I can't imagine working this hard on something I didn't really love. And so I think moving forward, my big lesson is, like, only work on things that I really love, and if that's a movie, then great. If that's a book, great. If that's a TV show, great.
Of course, the bad news is that in 80% of movie cases, you will not be there to have the conversation with Morton.
That's true.
On the way back from the set.
I've certainly heard, and it's, I don't know, I think, yeah, it's also trying to figure out what is the, I mean, there's another conversation we had about what is the writer's role in feature film, and I feel so lucky in this from this experience, like, we were such a small team. I mean, three producers, one director, I'm the only writer. You know, I wrote every word of this movie because there was, I mean, there was no one else. It was just me, and it was just, you know, the meetings were like the five of us. It was
and
so
British
small.
Actors who actually pay attention to what's on the script.
Very much so, and are very who are very informed and very well researched, and you know.
But they like to stay on the page. They're not. They don't tend to go loosey goosey.
Yeah. No.
Screenplays.
Yeah, and especially with this, because the dialogue's a bit stylized. Yeah. Like, it's not like the the style. I mean, as you know, you described it as Sirkian, but like it's not. The dialogue isn't naturalistic, or not quite. Like, it's sort of. It's written, it's composed, and that's part of the sort of aesthetic construction of the whole piece. But I remember this day on set. It was actually one of my... I remember this day where it was like... I can't remember what was going on, but we were all like stressed and tired. It was like a bad thing. Something was not going right. We were like, everyone was just grumpy. And I was like, I went back to my trailer grumpy and was like having a moment being like, ah, this is not working. And there's like a knock on the trailer door, and I go and answer, and it's Mark Strong, one of the actors in the film. And... you know, I've loved Mark's work for decades now, right? He's just an amazing actor. And he's like, oh, hey, Graham, are you busy? Can I come in? I was like, yeah, sure, Mark, come on in. So he comes and sits on the couch and is like, hey, I just, tomorrow's scene, I was going over the pages and I just, I don't understand, this one line doesn't make sense to me. Why am I saying this? And circles the line. And I was like, oh, well, I think it means, and we start talking about it and blah, blah, and we have a conversation. And he's like, so you mean to say that it's more like this as opposed to this, and gives me a few different, and we sort of talk about it, and he's like, okay, yeah, oh, I see what you're saying, okay, that makes sense, thank you so much, so sorry to bother you, all right. And then he leaves and goes back to sort of start preparing for tomorrow. And I had this moment of like, Mark Strong just asked my opinion about something. Like, Mark Strong cared what I had to say about some topic. Like, that doesn't happen every day. That's really cool. And I was totally out of my grumpy mood for whatever was like behind schedule that day, and could get back to work. And those are the sorts of moments where it was like, that collaboration with people who know a lot more than I do about the filmmaking process was so revelatory for me.
I guess that ultimately, because you will be more experienced in time.
I hope
it's
so.
Always, I mean, if it's another person of even of, you know, the same level experience or whatever, but to work with artists who actually give a shit and are there and working with you.
Yeah, I mean,
really working. It's a great thing.
Yeah, and I think that's, I mean, that's the, I think, again, having been through this all of once, my experience of it has been that, like, I couldn't imagine doing this with people who didn't care as much as I did. And, you know, I, going through this, like, I would so much rather make a movie with someone who cared just as much as I did and who disagreed. I mean, it's not like we always agreed on everything. Like, you know, Morton and I would stay up all night if we disagreed about something going through it. But because we were two people who knew the material really well, who are not shy about voicing our opinions and who, you know, could get into it. And I think that's, it's like you'd always rather fight every day with someone who cares than get along with someone who's apathetic about the material. It's like that, I don't know. That sounds more exhausting to me.
No doubt. Thank you so much.
Yeah,
for
thank
time.
You for having me.
Appreciate it.
Yep.